bound up and maybe some of our stresses. We get bound up, you know, when we fight with our spouses. We get bound up when, in struggles with our kids. You know, it's so easy to get bound up. To just get bound up in thinking about that and worrying about that. But here comes along Jesus and he says, I've come to set you free. You know, and when you find me, he who the Son sets free, you will be free indeed, you know. And he doesn't want us to be bound up. He wants us to live freely. Not worry about those things, because really the only thing that we should be concerned about is him and what he thinks about us. And so we can kind of let some of all that other stuff go, as long as we're doing it for him, you know. So if we're raising our kids for him, then we don't have to worry about what's going on. If we're living in our marriages to please God and to please our spouses, then we don't have to worry about all that. If we're working to please God in our jobs, then we don't have to worry about the financial stresses, because he's right there with us. We don't have to worry about what others think about us, because as long as we're doing it for him, then who can be against us? And so there's freedom in that. So maybe for whatever reason you're not free today. Maybe there's a lot on your plate. There's a lot on my plate. Maybe there's a lot on your plate. And you're not feeling very free. I think Jesus just wants to encourage you this morning, even with these words that we said this morning, there is freedom. There's freedom in me. Because he who the Son sets free, you will be free indeed. So live free. Can you live free today? Can you do that? Amen? Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Let's take a seat. And we will get on with the rest of this day. Man, what a great one. Yes. We'll let the Thanksgiving. We'll let the kids go down to kids' church. They are intensely working on the Christmas play. That'll be fun for when they put it on, won't it? Okay, well, Miles and I will have fun. It'll be fun when they do that. It'll be a great time. So I'm looking forward to it. I want to encourage you here today. God is here to encourage you today. He wants to awaken you to him. You know, maybe you're thinking, well, I'm already awake to God. Well, he wants to awaken you even more to him. He wants to invigorate your soul. He wants to inspire you for him to live the life that he has for you. And so, which is a lot why we're looking at what we've been looking at lately in the book of Acts. Because I think a lot of what we see in the book of Acts is a lot of what God wants for us to live. And so we've been looking at the book of Acts. We've been calling this series Authentic. Because what we see are authentic people living authentic Christian lives coming together as the authentic church in the book of Acts. Basically, what it all comes down to is Jesus says in Acts 1:8 that when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you will be my what? Help me out. I've made mention of this every week up to this point. You'll be my witnesses, yes. You will, but you will receive power to be my witnesses. Great. You'll receive power to be my witnesses. And so we're going to be, we've been taking a look at that. So what we see then is the disciples being filled with the Holy Spirit and then going out and telling people who Jesus is. And then they're doing what Jesus did. And so to be an authentic Christian, according at least to Acts, is to be a spirit-filled, spirit-empowered Christian. And an authentic church is a church that is spirit-filled and a spirit-empowered church. You know, the important actions that took place before the Holy Spirit invaded the scene with the disciples is that they did what Jesus told them to do, And they waited in Jerusalem on God for 10 days. And they were praying for those 10 days. Not necessarily that they were praying all day together, but we know that they were at least meeting during the Jewish prayer times, which was early in the morning and about the middle of the afternoon. They were getting together for those prayer times, waiting expectantly upon God to fill them with the Holy Spirit. Of course, they didn't know what that meant yet. They just knew that a promise was coming. That's all that they knew. They were getting together for prayer. They were not only waiting in Jerusalem, they were waiting on God. And we see this recurring theme throughout the book of Acts, that these authentic believers, that they are filled with the Holy Spirit as they wait on God. Even as they go about their ordinary day, doing ordinary things, living their ordinary lives, they are waiting on God. They want God to intervene as they go about living their lives. And like we've seen the last couple of weeks, that can have great outcomes, like people being healed and people becoming Christ followers. Or it can mean things like being in jail overnight and being questioned with your life on the line. The big part of it is that they relied on God so totally that the goal of their lives was to build the character of Jesus into their lives. And if you were in Sunday school, I brought this up again in Sunday school because I thought it was so perfect with how things were fitting in. That they built the character of Jesus into their lives up to the point of persecution. It was the goal of their lives was persecution. What an odd goal. Isn't it? What a strange goal. But if you go back and you look in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus says, "This is what the people of my kingdom are like." And he starts out with passion. Blessed are the poor in spirit. That's talking about passion. It's talking about desperation for God, needing God, ending with that character. Blessed are you when you are persecuted. The goal of their lives was to be persecuted. The goal of Christian faith is persecution. It's kind of a little bit backwards from what we learn, isn't it? A little bit different from what we learn normally. They were so thoroughly devoted that they allowed the Holy Spirit to lead them even into dangerous situations so Jesus' mission could be accomplished. And that is simply for the lost to be saved. Last week, we also prayed for the persecuted church, and there are people in the world that are in these dangerous situations and are being imprisoned, they're being beaten, tortured, starved, raped, burned, and whatever hideous things people or the demons that inspire them can think of to hurt people. And today we're going to pray for them again as well. What is amazing to me is how the church responded to this persecution. They were joyful. They were thankful that they were able to experience what Jesus experienced, that they were able to live in Jesus' life the way that he lived it, and they thanked God for it, and they prayed that they would continue to see Jesus' power on a daily basis. And when they did pray that in Acts chapter 4, the house shook. It says that it shook. The place where they were meeting was shaken, and the power of God fell, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And then even more happened. As the authentic church and these authentic believers were empowered by the Holy Spirit. And if we look at Acts chapter 4, we're going to pick up there. I'm just going to read through that real quick. Acts chapter 4, verses 32 through 37. And then we're going to go on from there. Acts chapter 4, verses 32 through 37. This is what happens even more. All the believers were in one heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there was no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold the field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. So, this is how chapter 4 wraps up. And then we're going to go into chapter 5. First, let me pick at least one thing out here. Look at this, what they're doing here. This sharing everything that they had and this, what they were doing, they were selling their homes and they were selling property and what to distribute and whatnot to distribute to those in need. What we see here is that how Luke describes this is that God's grace was working powerfully among them. It was a work of God's grace in their lives. It was a powerful work of God's grace. And let me say this, when we are willing to sacrifice on a level that it's going to cost us a level of a standard of living, that is a powerful work of God's grace, that we have to allow the Holy Spirit to work in our lives, and that's exactly what was going on there. Now, that is a stretch for us, isn't it? Let's just be honest, that's a stretch for us. To give to a point where it's going to cost us a standard of living, that's a stretch. But that's what's going on here. It was, Luke called it a work of God's grace. I believe it's a work of God's grace that he has for many believers, for all believers, I would even say. Remember last week we learned that the goal of our faith is not praise and rewards. It is that as we build the character of Jesus into our lives, it leads to what? I just mentioned it earlier.
Persecution.
Persecution. Leads to persecution. So let me say this. Another thing that's a little bit opposite of what we are taught and what is just kind of considered the way that we should live, the way that life should be, that the goal of our lives in following Jesus is not to get a larger bank account. It is not to have a nicer home. It's not to have nicer cars. What this shows us here in this passage, at least, is that God's grace working in our lives as we allow the Holy Spirit to do it is to be broke. A little bit opposite of what we typically learn the way life should be, isn't it? But the goal of our life shouldn't be to gain possession. It should be to give possession so that when we die, we're broke. That's the way that Jesus' disciples lived. It's the way the authentic believers lived. And that's what we see the believers doing here. And again, of course, we pick up on the story of a lot of you maybe that have been in church before, you know about Barnabas, this son of encouragement. He was a companion with Paul on a lot of Paul's missionary journeys later on in the book of Acts. This Barnabas, it picks up the story of him here because he took a piece of property, sold a piece of property, and laid it at the apostles' feet. Now, the story that we're going to look at, I'm going to say this, you probably haven't heard a lot of sermons on. in collecting many decades of sermons, Charles Spurgeon collected many decades of sermons, and there is not one sermon in all the sermons that Charles Spurgeon preached on this passage of Scripture, not one. Acts chapter 5. It is a hard, hard passage. In being honest, I don't know that I've ever preached on it before myself, but it is a part of Acts, and we are looking at the authentic church and being on authentic believers, and so this is part of it. Why don't you take a look at it with me? Acts chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Now a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. With his wife's full knowledge, he kept back part of the money for himself, but brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. Now, we don't know anything about Ananias and Sapphira in the scriptures except what right here, Acts 5. This is our only record of them. That's all we know about them. We can be pretty sure they saw what Barnabas had done and saw how well it was received by the church, even making him popular a little bit with this name, the Son of Encouragement. And let me ask you, who wouldn't want to be known as that? The Son of Encouragement. That's something I want to be known for, is to be this encouraging kind of guy. You know, and they might have wanted to be known for that too. You know, I would want to be known for being encouraging to people, for showing kindness and compassion to people so that they'll be better than they currently are. What a great thing to be known for. An encourager, huh? Anybody else want to be known as an encourager? Yeah. You know, we want to be known as encouragers. So if we just do, you know, if we just do what he did, then we'll get the same name as him, right? If we just do what he did. But already here we see something in Luke's writing that shows us that something's a little bit off with Ananias and Sapphira. He's picking up on something that, and if it would have been written differently, and it could have been written differently, it wouldn't be such a big deal. But the way it is written, Luke is accusing them of giving money, but keeping back part of it for themselves. Well, what's wrong with that? So I go out and I sell a piece of property, and I give some to the church, and I hold back some for myself. What's wrong with that? You know, what could possibly be wrong with that? And so we don't know if this was standard practice, that if you sold a piece of property, you were supposed to give it all to the church, or if you were selling a house, you were supposed to give it all to the church. We don't know. We don't know what standard practice was at this time. But they kept some of it back, and for whatever reason, that was wrong. And it may have been about the money. We don't know. But the way that Luke writes, it seems like it's more than just about the money, right? It seems like there's more to it than that. Look at this in verse 3, Acts chapter 5, verse 3 and 4. Then Peter said, "Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land?" Okay, lied to the Holy Spirit. This is a little bit more than money. No. "Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied just to human beings, but to God." So when we look at this conversation, it becomes very clear that there's a lot more to this than about the money, right? Right? We're all in this together. Help me out, right? There's more to it than the money. Yes, they kept back some of the money. How Peter knows this, we don't know. We don't know if it's just common knowledge of what property goes for during this time, or what it's sold for, or if the Holy Spirit just revealed to Peter as Ananias was doing this. We don't know. But by Peter's questions, we can see, though, that this wasn't about a requirement at all. It wasn't required to give at all. What we see is that Ananias lied about what he did with all of the money. And Peter basically tells him, you could have done whatever you wanted to do with the money. It was yours to start with. It was your property. When you sold it, the money was yours. You could have done whatever you wanted with it, which Ananias did, didn't he? He thoroughly did exactly what he wanted to do with the money. And that was that he conceived a plan to make it look like he was giving anything, everything, when really he was only giving a part of it. So then we can look at this and we know that God is, at least in some parts, speaking to Peter here, because Peter starts talking to Ananias about his relationship with the Holy Spirit. Ananias' relationship with the Holy Spirit. And there's only one way that can possibly be known. And that's if God was revealing it to Peter. Because only God can know what's going on inside of somebody between them and the Holy Spirit, right? At least I think that's the way it is. And so God was revealing this to Peter. God could only know, truly know, the condition of Ananias' heart. Just like God only truly knows the condition of your heart and the condition of my heart. And the condition was that Ananias had so thoroughly believed that he making people believe that he had given everything would make him not only important in their eyes, but it would make him important in God's eyes as well. Ananias was very deceived. And being very deceptive. It was spiritual deception. He made people believe that he was giving more than he really was. And by doing that, making himself more spiritual to the community of the Holy Spirit, a place in which God dwelled. He was lying not only to people, but he was lying to God as well. And the thing that's really difficult for us to happen is what happens next here as we take a look at this passage, Acts chapter 5, verses 5 and 6. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died. And great fear seized all who heard what had happened. Then some young men came forward, wrapped up his body, and carried him out and buried him. Now, one commentator suggests that the use of this word of Ananias' death, where it says Ananias fell down and died, that this word is used of a sudden, terrible, judicial death. To hear what Peter said and then to see what happened with Ananias, to me, it only makes sense to see this as God's judgment on Ananias' sin. And what makes this difficult for us to understand, and it's hard for me to understand, is for us to think that, why would God treat someone this way? What about an opportunity for repentance? Why didn't Ananias have this opportunity to repent? Why did Peter say these words and then Ananias fall over and die? Why didn't Ananias get a chance for his sin to be made right before God? Why did he just die? Why did God allow his judgment to come into his life? Anybody else struggle with that? Come on, be honest. You do, don't you? Yeah. Thanks. Marilyn and I, we're in this together. We're in this together. I don't get it. I don't understand why that would happen. Now, there are several answers, I'm sure. And if you read three commentators, you'd get four opinions. It's very possible that this was an act of mercy on both Ananias and on the church. This may have been an act that would have led to several acts for Ananias, taking him away from God. And so God allowed judgment for sin to come into his life and save his soul. It could also be that Ananias had just flat out lost the fear of God. And Jesus says, fear God, for he's the one that can throw both body and soul into hell, right? And it could have been. Whatever the case, to try to figure out whether Ananias was a Christian or not, and this was a merciful act or a judgment act, it's all speculation, you know? And so if you come to me later and you say, well, I think Ananias was a Christian, I'll say, I think you're speculating, because that's all you're doing. We don't know, you know? We don't really know. But we do know for whatever reason, when this started happening in the holy in the early church, the Holy Spirit was not going to allow this kind of deception in the church at this point. You know, this wasn't just a little half-truth, or it wasn't something that was a little bit true and a little bit false. It wasn't just something that was said or done in passing. This was a very deliberate act done on Ananias' part to deceive not only the people in the church, but to deceive himself into thinking he was more spiritual than he really was, that he was more spiritually committed, that he was more mature than he really was. He was not being truthful about his level of spiritual commitment. You know, and this isn't a matter of others thinking we're more spiritual than we are. You know, otherwise, most pastors that I know would be dead, right? Because most people think that pastors are more spiritual than they really are. The fact is that, sorry, I'm not that spiritual. You know, really, I'm not. This is Ananias making others believe he was more mature than he really was. He was doing it. You know, and the thing is, though, is that we can't look at this passage and sit in self-righteous judgment on Ananias, because many of us are guilty of the same thing. Right? Many of us are guilty of the same thing. We're guilty of the same thing when we say people, when we are people of prayer and we don't pray. We say we're guilty of the same thing when we are people, when we say that we're people that love God's word, when we won't read it or study it. When we talk about being generous and then we have a hard time spending money on something that is not for ourselves. When we talk about the importance of holiness and we do things to distract others from Christ, from following Christ. See, Ananias, he had a way out of this. All he had to do was say, hey, Peter, we were going to give everything like Barnabas, and we wanted so much to do what he did, but we decided to keep some for our own needs. We just aren't ready to give it all right now. He had a way out. But he didn't do that. And guys, And if you think about of what their honesty would have brought in that situation, they would have been closer and more a part of the church than they probably ever could have imagined if they just would have been honest in the situation. You know, you've heard me say this before, and I'll say this again. You've heard me even say it a lot already today. We're all in this together, right? We're all in this together. Not one of us is better than the other. I'm included in that. I struggle with a lot of the same things that you struggle with. And you're thinking, well, I struggle with this. You can't tell me that guy standing up in front of me struggles with that. You'd be surprised, okay? I struggle with many of the same things you struggle with day in and day out. And there are many of you that are more mature in Christ than I am. There is no reason for any of us to try to put out there that we have it all together. We don't have it all together. How many of you are in that with me? I do not have it all together. Thank you. or even that we have it mostly together. I don't even have it mostly together. I have just like maybe just a tiny portion together. And I'm going to go home and mess that up too later on. It's okay to say I'm struggling with this particular part of my life. It's okay to admit that to one another. It's okay to admit that I'm not mature in this part of my life. But to walk in and walk out and make people think that you are beyond your maturity level is wrong. That doesn't bring life. And in actuality, what Ananias experienced physically, we experience spiritually when we do this. We bring death spiritually because we are saying that we are already mature. And we don't need to mature anymore, and that the people around us need to mature so that they will be more mature like us. The thing is, and this is just my guess, we've all been there. We've all tried at some time to make ourselves seem more mature than we really are. And what I want for us, all I want for us is just to be the people who Jesus wants us to be. And if we're struggling, then let's struggle together and do what it takes to be true encouragers of one another and bring true life like a Barnabas and not death like an Ananias. We find out next that later on, 3 hours later, Sapphira walks in, and she was so completely convinced and deceived in this plan that her fate was the same as her husband's. The deception ran deep, for whatever reason, in this couple. And this is what I'm afraid. I'm afraid that it has run deep in the church as well. People that go to church are often called hypocrites by people that don't go to church, or by people that have become disenfranchised with the church. And unfortunately, it's true. It's true in a lot of cases. Deception is built into us by nature, by our sin nature. Think about it. Sin originally came into the world. Why? Because Adam and Eve were deceived by Satan into taking part of something that they didn't have a part of, that they weren't supposed to have a part of. And we are good at subtly altering the facts, from making the weight of the fish more or making our weight less, aren't we? We round up and we round down. The deception is all around us because we have allowed it, and we allow it to be a part of our lives, and unfortunately, it's in the church as well. Yet as the church, we are told emphatically in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25, therefore each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor. I like how the New Living Translation puts it. That's NIV. I like how the New Living Translation, it says, stop lying. Just stop it. Stop lying to each other. Speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. How can you lie to a part of your own body? So we need to ask ourselves the question, do I practice deception on a spiritual level? Do I attempt to skew or make people think that I am more mature in my commitment to Jesus and his body than I really am? When we do, we lose sight of the bigger picture. The bigger picture of life and death. And the bigger picture is that life and death spreads beyond us, doesn't it? I'm talking about spiritual life and death. It's beyond us, right? It spreads beyond who we are when we make decisions to put on a face of being more mature than we really are in Christ. It spreads beyond us. Yeah, it spreads to our community. Of course it does. It gets out there. It doesn't take long for it to get out there that this church, I'm not saying this church, you know what I'm saying. But when a church acts more holy than they really are, right? That gets out there, and it doesn't take long for that to get out there. But beyond that, individually, what about your children? What about your grandchildren? It's bigger than us. We lose sight of the bigger picture. Later, we see in Acts 5 that great fear came upon the church. Well, duh. Of course it came upon the church. Two people died because of sin in their lives. That's fear. That is something to fear. Great fear came upon the church. People began to honestly assess their spiritual condition. As a result, many more came into the church. Because as the fear of God came, so the power of God came, and God continued to do miracles in the church. See, God wants people to come and know Him, but it isn't going to happen when we live in a state of deception. You cannot be the person, and I dare you to write this down. If you've got your bulletin, I want you to write this down. You cannot be the person God wants you to be by trying to trick people into thinking you're somebody that you're not. You cannot be the person God wants you to be by trying to trick people into thinking you're someone you're not. That's what happened with Ananias and Sapphira. It's the same with us. And so I think there's some things that maybe we need to repent, for which we need to repent. So I'm going to invite you into a conversation today. Is that okay? You want to be a part of a conversation today? Be a part of a movement, of a group today? Let's be a part of the church today. Can we do that? Invite you into a conversation. We've been talking a lot, and I've been talking a lot lately about being Spirit-empowered, being Spirit-led, and how that all started out in the church in Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 1 is that they sat and they waited on the Lord. And we see this happening in different increments, that the church just waited. They came together, they prayed, they waited on the Lord, and God filled them with the Holy Spirit. And they went out then, and then they were Spirit-led more, and they were Spirit-empowered, and God did great things. And they came back, and they waited on the Lord. You know, and so we see this continual waiting on the Lord. And I've been talking a lot about that throughout this series. And how many of you would say that you're struggling with this? You're struggling with waiting on the Lord. Anybody here say, yeah, I'm struggling with that. Yeah, with waiting on God. It's okay, confession. It's good for the soul, right? It really truly is. It's good for the soul. That's not in the Bible necessarily, but it is. It's good. It's good to confess. We're all in this together, right? How many of you would say that, you know, you love to learn about what God did, but you're really struggling with reading and studying the Bible for yourself, doing that on your own time? You'd say, yeah, I'm struggling with that. Anybody here? Yeah. We're just inviting you into a conversation. It's okay. Let's struggle together, all right? How many of you would say that, and this might be hard to admit, but how many of you would say that there are some motivational issues, some issues of truly wanting to grow and mature in Christ, that you're not really sure even if you want to do that? Anybody here that you're not really sure? It's easy to say, yeah, I want to be that in this place, you know, here when we're all together, but what about when you go home? Anybody struggling with that? Maybe you struggle a little bit with that. That's okay. If you want to admit that, that's okay. How many of you would say, you know, a lot of us, we say that we care about people, but yet, you know, are you willing to go out and, when you go out, trash them behind their back and talk negatively about them and gossip about them to other people? That's a hard one to admit. How many of you would say that you want to become disciples, but you aren't willing, or that you want people to become disciples, but you aren't willing to spend time with them or pray with them or study God's word with them? You know, we all struggle, don't we? We all have these struggles. God, I'm having a hard time trusting you, you know, right now. You know, but we're all in this together. Let's struggle together. Let's make this work together. Right? Take a look around the room. Go ahead. Just go ahead. Look around the room. Look in everybody's face if you can. If you're in the back, that's going to be really hard. That's why it's good to sit up front. See, because I can see you on the face. But back there, you're just looking at the back of everybody's head. Haha. Winning. Now I've acted like I'm more mature than you. I made a fool of myself in the process. We're one body here today. We're all in this together. I struggle with a lot of the things that I mentioned. You struggle with a lot of the things I mentioned. We're all in this together, aren't we? Let me say this too, along that lines. And, you know, a lot of, you see this a lot in our country, especially in these conservative cultures that we're in. We're in a fairly conservative culture, you know. We're conservative in a lot of ways. We're conservative politically, we're conservative spiritually, morally, we're morally conservative kind of people, you know, generally. We're even conservative in the way we express ourselves, aren't we? We're just conservative type people. We conserve, we don't really, aren't out shouting it, you know, and that kind of stuff. We're just, conservative kind of people. A lot of times in these conservative mind thoughts, especially in churches, there's a way of looking up at the guy up front holding the mic, you know, or the guy up front speaking. All God has done is just gifted me with a gift. That's all. It doesn't make me any more spiritual than anybody else. That's all. He's just given me a gift of a heart to see things from a certain point of view. So, yeah, I care about people. I'm concerned about people. I desperately want to see the church grow. I'm not just talking numerically. I'm talking, I want to see you grow spiritually in mature in your relationship with God. He's given me a perception to a way to see things that way. It's just a gift. That's all it is. And that's all it will ever be if I don't mature that gift. The way I mature that gift is by going back and doing the same things that you have to do to mature your living in Christ every day. That's the only way we mature, is by reading the Word, praying, being led by the Holy Spirit, and following the Holy Spirit and being Spirit-empowered in our lives. It's the only way any of us grow. And so, can we just do that together? You know, and let's not put on airs that I'm just this some high, mature person, you know, and just let's struggle together, if you will. That way, at least like Ananias and Sapphira, if we're deceived, we're all deceived together anyway. No, but you know what I'm saying. But let's make this work together. You know, let's do it together. And the reason I had you take a look around the room is look who's here in this place today as we've gathered together. Look who's here in this place. And I dare you to as you've looked around, pick out one person in your mind and just give them a call this week and, hey, how you doing? That's all. Just, how you doing? Will you do that? Will you take that challenge with me this week? Would you do that this week? Doesn't even have to be a super spiritual conversation. Just, how you doing? How's life? You know, how are things? If you haven't done that in a while, will you take that challenge? Anybody take that challenge with me this week? Maybe you'll do that. Yeah, good. Good. All right, good.
Can we use an anonymous number?
Paul, is this you? Really creepy, Paul.
Thank you.
No. No, you can't. By the way, no. It's illegal. No, I'm kidding. Or, you know, stop by. Stop by their house. Say, hey, how's it going? You know, stop. If there's an opportunity and you can, stop by where they work. You know. How's it going? How you doing? Whatever the case is, let's do this together. You know, Acts 5, that is a hard passage, isn't it? It doesn't make sense to us all the time. Here this guy falls into sin, is deceived, falls down dead, and yeah, it's frightening. It's fearful. It should make us want to assess our own spiritual condition. It made me assess mine this week, believe me, as I read. I was like, oh, Lord, how am I going to preach this message and help help me not to die while I'm preaching. Serious. There are times, I'll be perfectly honest with you here right now, while I was preaching, I was a little weak in the knees. God, help me, don't help me not to preach something that I'm not. You know, I don't want to put on these airs of being this highly mature person when I'm not. I'm just struggling, just like everybody else. And I think we can all say that, can't we? That's good. Good stuff. Make a little segue here. Ananias and Sapphira, they gave, and you saw people in the book of Acts, they were just giving, and they were giving generously beyond themselves, to a point. They were willing to give, they were willing to give to a point that they were going to live on a lower standard. We see that a lot. And there are people that are our brothers and sisters in Christ. There are people that all around this world that are living on such a low standard that they don't even have the proper things to eat during the day. They don't have the things required to even survive throughout the day. And Jesus, I think, calls us to helping the poor and needy. He calls us to help the poor and suffering, those that don't have it and don't have access to it. And so that's why last week I introduced this thing called opportunity called One Day to Feed the World. And so I'm going to ask Clayton to play this video, and then I've got something for you as we go here. Go ahead, Clayton. Thanks.
Convoy of Hope is a nonprofit organization that has helped more than 67 million people throughout the world by feeding hungry children, educating farmers, empowering women, and bringing relief to families in need. The average person works 240 days per year. By giving just one day's wage to One Day to Feed the World, you restore power to the powerless. With that power, those nutritious meals really open the door to Christ's love, education, and much more for children in 11 nations and here at home. Your One Day transforms their every day.
When I was in the third grade, I had to stop going to school to earn money. One of my friends helped me get a job with a man. For a while, he helped us improve our life, but our relationship became devastating to me. I became a prostitute for the man. I was only 11 and he was my first. I had no choice. There was nothing I could do. It was the only way we could live. My mom developed cancer and we had no way to pay for her expenses. The man told me that if we continued our relationship, he would help us. At the end of my mother's life, the man had left. By the time I was 14, I was married to a different man and had three children. My husband was very sick and weak. He couldn't work, so I had to take care of my children, I had to take care of my husband, and I had to work. I was watching my children be hungry. There was nothing I could do for them except be hungry with them. At the time, I was attending a church and one of the people there told me that there were some people starting a program for a woman and I might be a part of it. When we started the training, I thought to myself, this is for real. And I was really happy. I own a poultry business. The first time I sold my chickens, I doubled my investment. What you're giving me is not wasted. Not on me. Before, my children were hungry. They would cry and cry and make my ears ring and my heart ache. But now that they have food to eat, they smile and are happy. Seeing them now makes me overjoyed.